Let's read this together. So you can see on the screen, I will read the section in white, and congregation, you can read the section in yellow. Psalms 118. O give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His steadfast love endures forever. Let Israel say, his steadfast love endures forever. Let the house of Aaron say, his steadfast love endures forever. Let those who fear the Lord say, his steadfast love endures forever. Out of my distress, I called on the Lord. The Lord answered me and set me in the broad place. With the Lord on my side, I do not fear. What can mortals do to me? The Lord is on my side to help me. I shall look in triumph on those who hate me. It is better to take refuge in the Lord than to put confidence in mortals. It is better to take refuge in the Lord than to put confidence in princes. I was pushed hard so that I was falling, but the Lord helped me. The Lord is my strength and my might. He has become my salvation. There are glad songs of victory in the tents of the righteous. Open to me the gates of righteousness, that I may enter through them and give thanks to the Lord. This is the gate of the Lord. The righteous shall enter through it. I thank you that you have answered me and have become my salvation. Stone of the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. This is the Lord's glory. It is marvelous in our eyes. It is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. We bless you from the house of the Lord. The Lord is God, and he has given us light. Bind the festal procession with branches up to the horns of the altar.
You are my God, and I will give thanks to you. You are my God, I will extol you. Oh, thanks to the Lord, he is good, for his steadfast love endures forever.
The next passage of scripture is from Matthew chapter 21. Traditionally, when a passage from the gospel is read in church in the congregation will stand as a sign of honor and respect for the gospel. So shall we do that? Shall we rise as we again read this passage responsively? So again, I will do the passage, the sections in white, you will do the sections in yellow. When they had come near Jerusalem and had reached Bethphage at the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, "Go into the village ahead of you, and immediately you will find a donkey tied and a colt with her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, just say this, the Lord needs them, and he will send them immediately." This took place to fulfill what had been spoken through the prophet, saying, The disciples went and did as Jesus had directed them. They brought the donkey and the colt and put their cloaks on them, and he sat on them. A very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, and others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. The crowds that went ahead of him and that followed were shouting,
"Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest."
When he entered Jerusalem, the whole city was in turmoil, asking, "Who is this?" The crowds were saying, "This is the prophet Jesus from Nazareth in Galilee." This is the word of the Lord.
Good morning, my brothers and sisters in Christ, my family, as well as friends who are here, perhaps visiting for the very first time. The Lord bless you on this Palm Sunday. Today I'll be sharing on this topic on cultivating a healthy expression of worship, and Gilbert has led all of us through the scriptures on these two texts. Well, 2 years ago, I attended an award ceremony at the Istana. I mean, it's an invitation from the Istana. How rare for one person to get such an invitation. And I was elated and super excited. And on that day itself, I really prepared myself. I dressed properly, and then I went all the way there, wondering, how does the inside of the Istana look like? Well, 30 minutes before the president arrives, we had to rehearse our welcome. Everything had to be orderly and timely. And the MC of that day actually said to all of us, "Welcome to the Istana. Once I announce the president's arrival, I need all of you to stand to your feet and then be very attentive. Need you to clap as he walks in. Clap until he reaches his seat. And once the president takes his seat, you may sit down. Okay, you ready? We're going to practice, all right?" So that's what he said to us. So they got a double. Oh, right, a president double. And then he practiced. And so the MC announced, and then we all have to practice clapping all the way till the double, you know, stand there. And then the MC said, "Very good. However, you know, not enough strength. It's quite weak, the applause, so I want you to do again." So we practice, and then we practice. So we had to practice three times. And then the MC said, "All right, you're ready? You can all sit down." So that's actually the chandelier in one of the rooms, a lot of chandelier. It's so beautiful, I have to take pictures of the chandelier. So as we sat down, we sat in quietness. And there's this thing about silence. Silence has a way to mount anticipation. And so the anticipation actually mounted. And the moment that the president arrived, it's like action. No one could deny, right? The applause for the president was indeed loud, it was clear, it was concerted, done all together. No one can deny that it was not fake, it was not staged at all. And in that applause, we can all hear the admiration as well as the gratitude that we have for the president, for everything that he has done and is doing for our nation. I left that day, I left the Istana that particular late afternoon in deep reflection. Deep reflection, you know why? Because I've always been hearing this from the illustration of other preachers. Now that I experience it, it is real. You need to rehearse, and you know, it caused me to think about this particular question. If there is a proper posture and an expression to assume with a human king, and in this aspect, with the president, then what is appropriate when we come together to welcome as well as to worship the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords? Just what does the Bible say about our expression in corporate worship? And I believe that a healthy corporate expression of worship begins with the health of a single worshiper. What is the posture that we need to adopt when we come to meet our Lord, who is also a Savior, and a Savior who is also a King? Now, the New Testament doesn't tell us how long the corporate service should be, how many songs are to be sung, and how many of the songs must be hymns, how many of it must be psalms or choruses. It doesn't tell us how long to stand or how long to sit. Neither does the New Testament even scrutinize the style of or the type of music or the kind of instruments to be used. Of course, we know that the book of Corinthians does talk about, you know, address some part of worship because the people were becoming unorderly in that aspect. So there is that part in the book of Corinthians that addresses it. But then, if you think about it, what exactly does the Bible tells us about worship? I think the Bible tells us that worship is an expression. It's an expression of awe and love for God with our mind, with our heart, with our soul, and also with our strength. And apart from that, we know that worship is an expression that involves our attitude and also involves our action. And we all hope that it will be a healthy expression when we meet the King every Sunday, don't we? So we're going to use these two texts to guide us along. Something to know about the facts of Psalm 118 first. First off, this psalm is written by, most of the scholars believe, King David. In fact, King David is such a creative worship leader. Many of the psalms that he has written are expressive psalms. Psalm 118 is a song of thanksgiving for God's redemption and deliverance, because the big idea is this. The big idea he has for his reader is this: never forget. Never forget the rescue, out of your rescue, out of adversity, and then to rejoice in the fact that God saves you. This is also the song that Jesus and his disciples sang before, in the Last Supper, before they left to the, for Mount Olive. In Matthew 26, verse 30, as well as Mark chapter 14, verse 26, it tells us that Jesus and his disciples sang a hymn. And in case you wonder what hymn exactly is that they sang together, it was this particular one, Psalm 118. Wow, when I think about that, I was like, oh, Jesus sang. How would he sound? Must have a beautiful voice. I would love to be there to listen, to Jesus singing. Jesus sing. Today, modern Israel, the Jews are so singing the psalm on special festive occasions and on special days in anticipation for the coming Messiah and also for the final deliverance of God's people. And you know something? Verses 25 and 26 in this psalm, we also recite it on every Holy Communion. Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. And we said that. And so from there, I want to draw three points that we can learn from this text. Firstly, a healthy worshipper responds to the call to worship. Verses 2 and 4 says, let Israel say, let the house of Aaron say, and let those who fear the Lord say. Here, King David calls out to his hearers to the praise of God. And it is a call. This call to worship is a call of praise and a call of thanks to God. Note here that this is not only specifically given to the king, not specifically only given to priests, but it's given to all who fear the Lord. In other words, it's a call to worship for all of God's people. It's as though David is saying to the people, if you have enjoyed the benefits of God's goodness and unfailing love, then come and worship the Lord. Come and express your thanks to God. And you can see that in verse 1, as well as the last verse, verse 29, it says the same thing. Give thanks to the Lord for his steadfast love. And so observe this, when it is said once at the beginning, and it's said, at the last part of it, it's actually an emphasis. That's the theme of it, is to give thanks to the Lord. It's a call. It's a corporate call to worship. Now, our corporate worship mirrors this call. If you think about it, you look at your bulletin, right? Your bulletin actually has a call to worship. Is it because we have too many pieces of paper to weigh, so we decided to, print it out? No, I would say that our pattern of corporate worship mirrors David's call. Now, this call is given by the worship leader every Sunday, when the worship leader, or who is also the lead worshipper, steps up onto the altar. We don't call this a stage, because this is the altar of the Lord. And when the lead worshipper steps out to the altar of the Lord, this This lead worshipper is not here to sing his favorite worship song. This lead worshipper is not here just to actually fill up with a few songs of praise before the preacher or the pastor come up here to preach the word of God. No. This lead worshipper is actually here to call every one of us here to attend to the steadfast love of the Lord, just as the psalmist did. So why is this call so important? Why is this corporate call to us so important? I think it's for several reasons. My friends, we live in a society that teaches us to think well of ourselves. Many times, perhaps think too much of ourselves. We are fiercely independent and we are highly individualistic. All through the week, we find ourselves stuck in this whole matrix of brokenness, the matrix of sin. And in a sense, we can forget God. We can forget about who we are. We can forget the fact that His promises to us in Jesus Christ. In fact, we can forget for the fact that we are designed for union as well as communion with our Maker. And this forgetfulness can somehow lead us to worship lesser things. Perhaps certain people, prestige, power, possessions, or a so-called perfect life. And so this call to worship for all of us is very important because it's like a bucket of cold water to jolt us back to reality. Back to the reality and puts us back at our rightful place and to remind us of our identity in Jesus Christ, that you and I, we are redeemed people of the Lord, and yet at the same time, foreigners, aliens in this world, and that God actually has a summons on our life. And we are reminded that we are treasured and loved by God. Think about it. You and I come on a Sunday worship not because we plot 10:30 onto our iPhone, not because we plot this into our calendar, not because we slot him into our Sunday schedule, that's why we are here to worship. No, because we come to worship because God initiates with us. It is He who initiates us and calls us into worship. In fact, in his book, Worship and the Reality of God, Jefferson Davis said this, and he writes this one thing. When we recognize God as the central reality on Sunday, when God, not the human being, is seen as the central actor to whom we must all respond, then every element of worship will be seen to serve God's purpose. Even the announcements. Because the announcements are not random activities. The announcements are part of equipping, it's part of calling us into service as well. And so therefore, when we begin to see God as the central actor, every element of worship serves God's purpose. And we will realize that this is no mere human meeting planned and controlled by our human agendas. It is a special meeting called by God on His divine authority, for His purpose of meeting with His people. And we are called to lay aside our personal agenda, to realize where we are and what we are to be doing, and then to focus our attention on the unseen God, and to yield to Him our full awareness and our full attention. What does this imply for our life? What is he exactly saying in this whole nutshell? Basically, that the king keeps a special appointment with us. Our king keeps a special appointment with us. And what does this mean, basically, therefore? It's like, as I prepare myself to meet the president, it could also mean this, that we begin our days preparing to meet with the king here in the sanctuary. In fact, even on a Saturday, we prepare ourselves. And then we come. We come early. And then we come here ready to respond and ready to praise the Lord. For the Lord, God Himself, He does not wait on us. We wait on God. He has a summon in our life. Therefore, this means that He gets the first word the king gets the first word at the call of worship, and he gets the last word at the benediction. And that's why the benediction is so important, for it's the pronouncement of the Lord's blessing on our life before he sends us off into service in the world. A healthy worshiper responds to the call to worship. And a healthy worshiper recognizes reasons to praise God. The psalmist has reasons to praise God, and he articulated it. Israel and himself had experienced deliverance, and he used various word pictures to tell us exactly what he experienced. And I love this word picture. The very first thing he talked about is being in a very tight space and how God actually rescued him and put him on a spacious ground. How the Lord has actually rescued him from the stresses and the pressures of life. Isn't it true that like a tight tunnel, the stress suffocates? But the Lord heard the cry of David. He heard his distress and pulled him out from a tight hole and then put him on a spacious place. Not only that, the other picture that David used is that he was being pursued by his enemies, enemies that are like bees, swarms of bees, numerous. They come from all sides to sting him and to hurt him, and his pain swelled. I do not know about you whether you have been stung by a bee before. My mom had been stung twice by a bee, and twice in those occasions she was so frightened she thought that she's going to die, you know, because she doesn't know whether it's a poisonous bee. So I always have to tell her, "Mom, you know, relax, don't worry so much. You know, we're going to get through this. It's fine." Yeah. So yeah, she's fine. The bee sting can swell. The bee sting, the sting of hurt can swell. And David realized that these bees were pursuing him. But then he noticed one thing though. He realized that he doesn't need to squash and crush those bees, because the mighty right hand of God will exterminate them like a crackling fire in thorns. Crackling fire in thorns, another image. The Lord will extinguish them like crackling fire in thorns. Now, the people of God really know their stuff. That if you want a fire to burn slow, you use wood. You use wood if you want a fire to burn slow. But if you want to start a fire fast, you use thorns. But the fire from thorns are always short-lived. And so in this sense, David was affirming that even though the enemy's fierce threat, the attacks may be obvious, it may be even loud, and it's be annoying, they will be ineffective, they will be meaningless and pointless, because the Lord himself will snuff them out. At the end, the nation, as well as David himself, they will experience the sweet honey that comes from this beast. Sweet victory. If we were to ask David what's the secret of his success, he tells in Psalm 118, the name of the Lord. It's the name of the Lord that cuts out all his adversaries and the adversity he faced. The name of the Lord is a powerful weapon. It never fails on any day of the battle. It never fails. Why? Because God remains faithful to his name, and God will act according to his name. Those who know how to use this weapon can chase 1,000 annoyances. This Monday when I woke up, there was a very, very annoying hip pain that I actually have on the right side. And I find so much difficulty in turning around. And you know, my waist was so painful. And so my husband asked me, you know, did you do something strenuous such that you can't move? And then to that response, I was jesting with him, did you actually attack me in my sleep and punch me at the waist? And so we were laughing. You know that it wasn't. It was a strange occurrence. It just happened. And it got worse off as the day go by. And I know immediately that that's actually not something that is you know, due to exercise, but it's a distraction. You see, because this week I have an assignment to actually talk about the identity of Jesus Christ to the GB girls. And I also have an assignment to be talking about the baptism of the Holy Spirit as well as to preach on Sunday. And as it got worse off, you know, I find myself being distracted. But then when I remember as I was preparing this, you know, the Lord is so timely. So remind me, right, that I don't need to worry because the name of the Lord will be true. I just need to call on the name of the Lord. I remember, I say, the name of the Lord is a deliverer. And, you know, Lord, deliver me from this pain of distraction. The Lord's name is a shield and a shelter. I will just hide under the shadow of His wing. I'm not going to let this pain, you know, abort what God is sending me to do. I'm not going to let this pain, right, cause me to raise a white flag. I'm just going to trust in the name of the Lord. And then I begin to understand why. Because on Friday, after I shared about the identity of Jesus Christ to the girls, six Sec 1 girls for the very first time gave their life to Jesus Christ. You see how cunning the enemy is whenever he comes to annoy you, when he comes to disturb you. It's actually to basically stop the purpose, perhaps in which to stop the purpose of God from being fulfilled in your life, to abort that mission. So that you will doubt the goodness of God, you will doubt the power of God. But here, David says, those who know how to use the name of the Lord like a weapon, you can chase 1,000 annoyances. There are many daily irritants that seek to dampen our trust in God, be it conflicts at home, conflicts at work, even sometimes pain that might occur in a church that stings, heartache and diseases, or even anxieties that come from deadlines that suffocate us as though we are in a tunnel. Friends, we don't naturally see that we need the deliverance of the Lord until we encounter desperate situations. And then we cry out to the Lord to save us, to help us. And then isn't it wonderful that every time when we do that, God offers timely help and timely love? In fact, worshiping in a congregation like this is a very powerful expression. It's a powerful expression to call on the name of the Lord together. Because when we take on the name of the Lord on our lips in praise, we are actually strengthening our spirit, we are strengthening our soul, we are also covering the person next to us who perhaps might be feeling weak. And in declaring that, the word of the Lord, and in singing in praise to Him, we're actually saying, Lord, You are my ally. You are my leader. I'm with You, and I choose Your side. I choose to trust and believe. And so are you actually going through maybe a crossroad or difficult challenges? Then I encourage you this week to take on the name of the Lord on your lips, to praise Him, to really praise the Lord, to experience a breakthrough. And if you have already experienced a breakthrough, continue to praise the Lord, because a healthy worshiper recognizes reasons to praise God. Thirdly, a healthy worshiper is a responsive worshiper of God. Now, when I talk about being responsive, I'm not preaching emotionalism here, all right? I'm actually talking about expression. These days, we have a lot of singing competition out there that we can watch, be it The Voice, right? Be it 中国好声音, and we catch those either on YouTube. And then we look at the expression of this singing contestant. You know, sometimes it's like a facial contortion, you know, when they sing, you know, so expressive. But I'm actually talking about a kind of appropriate expression to our king. Because when you look at David, he's pretty expressive. He says that, it says that he expressed anguish and he cried out to the Lord. There were shouts of joy and victory in the tents of the righteous. He enters into the Lord's presence and he gives thanks and then he rejoices and he's glad. Not only that, he praised the Lord and then he exhorts the Lord. Now the word exhort, right? The word exhort basically means to raise the volume of praise. Raise the volume of praise till it reached the ceiling of the roof. Pretty expressive, huh? Sometimes the English word can be such a weak coach. Because when I say praise the Lord, or I say thank God, immediately you will think about using words. Words that can be spoken, words that can be heard, maybe sometimes you think that, oh, just soft words in that sense. But in the Hebrew root word, right, this verb, the Hebrew verb in itself, means yada. And by this, I don't mean yada, 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 you know, the meaningless ranting that we try to shut people up, you know, when we want to say, stop it. Not that kind of yada. This yada here means to confess God. To confess God, and then to give thanks and praise, to confess and to, in a way, to revere and to worship Him, and many a times with a reference of using hands. Using hands, either in an outstretched posture with raised hands, implying surrender, implying intimacy. To lift one's hand in praise and thanksgiving, the spreading forth of the hands in prayer is also recorded in Jewish as well as Christian sources. Three other physical forms of expressions are also recorded in Scripture. They include our spoken voice, which is speaking, shouting, and singing. Our posture, that includes bowing, standing, dancing, and then our hands, playing of instruments, clapping and lifting it up to the Lord. But some might say, but I object to such kind of expression because the New Testament doesn't really talk about it. It's only in the Old Testament, but the New Testament doesn't really talk about it. Maybe you can consider the context of the New Testament church, living in a very hostile environment where there's persecution. Perhaps then in a corporate setting, it might not be very wise for them to be totally out, knowing that it may even cost them their life. However, it is sincere nonetheless. Their expression is sincere nonetheless. These expressions and postures that I'm mentioning sometimes can stretch some people here. Some of us here feel that our personalities do not favor this type of action. It's just not us, it's not our personality. And sometimes I will hear people telling me that God sees the heart. God sees my heart. God sees the heart of the worshiper. And in a way to suppress expression to the King of Kings. Now, I'm not advocating, my friends, I'm not advocating that every song that we sing has to be dramatic. But then we must be very careful. Careful not to use our personality types as an excuse for not giving our all before the cross. Let us be very careful to hide behind our personality types and say, nah, that's just not me. Just because God sees our hearts does not mean that everything that we do will always be in accordance to His will and to His thoughts. After all, Jeremiah the prophet said, our heart is deceitful above all else. And the wise teacher in Proverbs says that our ways are always right in our own eyes. And we are also prone to be embarrassed by what the person on the left and on the right and in front think about us, think about our expression. Some would encourage us not to trust our feelings and our thoughts of our hearts too much. Instead of forcing you to raise your hand in worship or to stretch it out in prayer, let me encourage us to draw near to God during our times of thanksgiving and praise. Let's just draw near to God and ask God this question, Lord, are there anything in my heart? Are there any sin in me that inhibit praise that you deserve? Are there anything that's stopping me from giving you my all? You see, God looks at the heart, but He also equally looks at our responsive expression. You see, God wires our body in such a way that it naturally, you know, responds to how we feel. And therefore, what we express outwardly is also an indication of the inward reality. a posture during praise, corporate praise and worship with arms folded could be an indication that the sanctuary is very cold. So we need to generate warmth. Arms folded could also mean that many of the songs may be very, very new. Instead of helping you to sing and worship, it actually hinders you from drawing near to the Lord. And that's where the worship team has to always have the responsibility of teaching the new songs. And we need to learn new songs, but not too many new songs at one time. And that's where the worship team will have to be teaching, because songs are meant for us to draw near to God. But at the same time, a folded hand could also be an indication of the lack of awe and the lack of respect of God. In the passage of the triumphant entry, we read of the disciples' praise of God and of Jesus. They joyfully praise God in loud voices for all the miracles that they have seen. In fact, the crowd joined in the chorus. And what was this chorus? It's from Psalm 118, 25-26. Hosanna in the highest, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. And this whole large crowd joined in together. And then you realize they spread their cloak. They spread their branches. And you know that when anyone spreads anything, right, it's not just like take out and then like, you know, drop onto the floor. It includes a posture of bowing as well. And if I could draw a similarity, the spreading of the cloak and the branches is just like the fireworks on our National Day celebration. Woo! It's a big celebration. It's a celebration to indicate loyalty. Loyalty to Jesus. A celebration of praise, right, that came from street corners and rooftop. That's what the triumphal entry is all about. Jesus, think about that. Jesus received loud jubilation from a people who misunderstood his identity, who misunderstood his mission in life. They call him the prophet. They didn't recognize him as Messiah. Yet Jesus received that loud jubilation. Then what about us? We are redeemed people of the Lord. We are called the righteous one. We are the one who know. And in fact, we are the recipients. We are the recipients of his plan and of his mission. Should we give him less? A healthy worshiper responds to the call of worship, recognizes reasons to praise God, and is responsive to God. My friends, this season towards the Holy Week, it's a really good time to examine our posture and our expression to our King. The fundamentals of expressive worship is such that this praise is offered to God, not to men. This praise is offered to God. In fact, God doesn't delight in empty praise. It's not lip service. And sometimes some of us struggle to worship God. It's also because we do not really know. Because who you do not know, you cannot worship. And so to help us with that, actually, in collaboration with Euphoria, we came up with this Bible reading plan that we launched this year. And so the second quarter came out. It's already online, Go Green. It's on our website. But for those of you who need hard copy, it's a journal every day that tells you a text from the gospel that you could be reading, and then for you to journal, you know, what you observe about the person of Jesus, his miracles, his work, and how you are responding to him. So if you need a copy later, you can go out and grab one at the desk. King David calls his people to praise and thanksgiving because for them, they experience deliverance from a literal Egypt. Literal oppressors. In the Bible, sometimes Egypt is also a symbol of the world. And we have a reason to be expressing our praise to God because the Lamb of God, that is Jesus Christ, he is the deliverer. He is a deliverer, our deliverer from a bondage of false gods. And today is still delivering us from our fiery trials. Because He's our deliverer, He is worthy of our praise. And so don't hold back. Praise the Lord. Truly praise the Lord, because He's deserving of all, our King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Let's just spend a quiet moment to reflect and then express your praise to the Lord through prayer. And the worship team can come up and lead us. Let's just take one moment to articulate a specific thanksgiving to something that the Lord rescued you from this week. If not for His works, what about praise Him for His person? Father, Your call is a call of love that comes out to us. For You, Lord, are a God who is true to Yourself. You never fail. You are a God of steadfast love. You, Lord Father, are our deliverer. You, Lord, rescue us from the tight spot of darkness. From that tight spot, Lord, You transfer us to a broad land filled with good things and full of light and full of love. Forgive us, O Lord Father, for our fear. Those times, O Lord Father, where we withheld the praise that is truly Yours. Forgive us, O Lord Father, for attributing praise to things, to other persons that are not God. And we thank You, Lord Father, for Your gracious forgiveness. Teach us, God. And that's why You have given us the Holy Spirit. For Your Holy Spirit is teaching us how to cry out to our Abba Father. Teach us, O Lord Father, to respond to You in gratitude and in praise. Teach us. We have so much to learn, O Lord Father, about worshiping You together as individuals and as a church together. Lead us, Lord, so that every time, Lord, our praise will bring the greatest glory to You. Pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.